The world is changing rapidly. It seems every day there's a new technology or new product guaranteed to improve all of our lives. It can sometimes be hard to keep up with. The same thing is true for our state. Tennessee is rapidly changing. People are migrating here from every corner of America and from all over the world. But with change comes opportunity. And Tennessee Baptists are perfectly positioned to have a Great Commission impact. For instance, Tennessee Baptists have had a hand in planting an Afghan church and a refugee support center in Memphis. People are hearing the gospel many times for the first time and have the opportunity to be saved, baptized, and set on the road to discipleship in a church that speaks their language. Ford Motor Company has announced the Blue Oval City near Stanton. It will be the largest automotive manufacturing plant in North America. Tennessee Baptists are already developing a church planting strategy to reach the more than 8,000 workers and their families who'll be moving to the area. And our Tennessee Baptist Collegiate Ministries keep making disciples who make disciples. Many of the students they reach experience their call to ministry while members of a BCM, and they go on to serve our local churches. And in East Tennessee and throughout the state, Compassion Ministries continue to support churches serving others in their communities. These are golden opportunities made possible because Tennessee Baptists faithfully gave through the golden offering for Tennessee missions. You know, God tells us in Isaiah 43 to watch because He is going to do a new thing. That means Tennessee Baptists need to keep pace. If you and your church have never given through the GOTM, won't you consider joining thousands of other Tennessee Baptists as we reach our state for Christ? And if you do support the Golden Offering, I just want to say two words to you. Thank you. For you see, any way you slice it, Tennessee is a mission field. I look forward to being with you on this journey as we together win Tennessee for Jesus.
Let's give God a hand for that report. Amen. Amen. Well, it's always good to see Pastor Randy. We just love him, of course. He's one of our own, and we're just excited as a church. If you want to know, if you're visiting with us and you're connecting with us online maybe for the first time, or you've been journeying with us for a little while and just praying, is this a church for me? If there's one thing you need to know about First Baptist, is not only our love for Jesus and love for you, it's that our love to partner to get the gospel literally around the world. And it starts right here at home. Even this morning as we were praying over Pastor Dean, I mean, we were hearing reports about what God's doing at God's Warehouse and all around the incredible area. As a matter of fact, I'm rocking my Carson Newman this morning because we won our home opener yesterday. We're so proud of that. But even more so, even this last week, we saw 17 athletes baptized because they had given their heart and life to Jesus Christ. Amen. Can you believe that, church? God is moving. He's doing an incredible thing, and we're excited, as Pastor Dean affectionately calls our Golden State offering, the big orange offering, amen? So we come dig deep and give huge, because again, this is one of those offerings that literally stays in Tennessee, that we're literally planting churches all over the state, and a percentage of that money comes right back to our association. So every ministry that we're a part of, even in our local area, is getting that money back. So again, it's just like the gospel. It goes forth and it comes back, reaping benefit, amen? And so we're excited. We want you to pray about that. You can go online on our app. There's an option to give there as well, and through your Sunday school class, through your offering. So lots of opportunities for us to be the church. Amen. So let's take this moment this morning and let's just go to the Lord in prayer as we continue to worship. Father, there's just so much, God, that we could take during this time of worship and adoration to just give you praise, just like we've seen on and heard and with our own eyes, just a quick portion of what you're doing in our state. And the fact that, God, we get to be a part of that is just overwhelmingly humbling, Lord, in our heart. Lord, just celebrating not just the baptisms of what happened in and through our ministry and our local university, Lord, but just what you've been doing. Even today, God, another one. Just seems like every Sunday we're doing baptisms in one of our services, and we get to see that today. at the 11 o'clock, Lord. And so, God, we just give you praise that your promise is true, that you will build your church. And Lord, I thank you, God, that First Baptist Church is your church and that we love you, Lord, and you are our head. And Lord, that your under-shepherd, our pastor, Brother Dean, preaches your word just same as you laid out for us, Lord, full of grace and truth. And so, Lord, we stand today believing, God, that you're not finished with us. Lord, that you're doing a work in our country and you're doing a work in our area and around the world. And God, we just want to be a part of it. And so, Father, I pray for that precious soul that's visiting for the first time or tuning in for the first time. It may be introduced to who you are. Just that you would reveal yourself to them and show them the same grace and love that you have shown us. Lord, that we would be strengthened by your grace and an opportunity for folks. Lord, that we could introduce people to you, Lord. That we could come alongside and minister and serve. And Lord, even now, even as we know through this service, God, you're going to be saving people. You're going to be encouraging your Christians, your church, your children, Lord. You're going to be helping marriages and you're going to be reconciling relationships, Lord. So we give you all the praise. So as we continue to sing to you and we continue to pray, and then when the bread of life is opened up to us, the word of God, Lord, let us be not only hearers of the word, but doers of your word. So Lord, we give you praise. We thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen.
Amen. And as we look around this country, as we look around our world today, can't you just sense the return of our Lord is near? May we be faithful to tell others. Listen to these words. Let it be said of us that the Lord was our passion, that with gladness we bore every cross we were given. Whatever he gives us, may we be faithful to take it up and to live it for him. Let's stand together as we sing.
Let it be said.
Do not fear any of those things which you are about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and you will have tribulation in 10 days. But be faithful unto death, and I will give you a crown of life. May we each purpose in our hearts to be that faithful follower of Christ that the world may know. Oh, may all who come behind us find us
Jill, thank you so much for blessing our hearts. And Jill just retired after 32 years of being an educator, and we praise God for all of our teachers, our educators. And Jill, thank you for the message of that song. Folks, this is how we fight. We fight through the gospel. We fight through proclaiming the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to a lost and dying world. And let me also say good morning to all of my church family, and good morning to those who are watching by way of television and live stream. Well, I hope you are ready to get into the Word today. Our series is entitled A Living Faith in the Midst of a Hostile World. Our text this morning is going to be out of the little book of Jude. Find the book of Revelation in your Bible, the very end of the Bible, and then go back one book and you will find the little book of Jude. It's only one chapter, but it's a powerful message. And I want to share out of verses 3 and 4. It'll be page 1086 in your pew Bible if you want to follow along that way. As believers, we are in a battle for the very soul of Christianity. We are living in a culture that is increasingly more hostile to Christ and to His Word. And hey, would you like some good news this morning? It's going to get worse. You say, Pastor, that's not what I came to hear this morning. But folks, it's the truth. And it's true because of what the Word of God says. The closer we get to the time of the return of Jesus Christ, the more difficult it is going to become to be, or it will be, to be a believer in Christ. I just have to say this to you. One of the reasons some of you have noted the fact that I have preached a lot of messages in 2022 on being in the battle, staying in the battle, fighting the battle, going through the tough times. It's because in December of last year, I was praying, Lord, what do you want me to focus on and preach on in the year 2022? And I'm telling you, it's just like the Holy Spirit was speaking to my heart. I want you to preach to get my people ready. I want you to preach to get them ready for what is ahead. I don't want them to be blindsided. And so my messages, I pray, have been helping us to get ready for the days that are ahead. In this series, we have identified that there are only two agendas among all the agendas and strategies of this world. There's God's agenda and there is Satan's agenda. God's agenda is always based on the authority and truth of His Word. Satan's agenda is based on lies and deception and a distortion of God's Word. God's agenda always leads to life and abundance. Satan's agenda always leads to death, chaos, and to destruction. It is crystal clear, ladies and gentlemen, that Satan has an agenda of destruction for both our nation as well as all the peoples of this world. But God sent His Son to rescue us from Satan's agenda. We also discovered a couple of weeks ago that of all the people groups in the entire world, there's 8 billion people on our planet, right at 8 billion people, but there's only two groups of people. There are the lost and there are the saved. John 3:18 reminds us, look at the screen for a moment. He who believes in Him, in Jesus, is not condemned. That's the good news for those of us who are saved. But here's the bad news for those who are lost. But he who does not believe is condemned already. Right now, this very moment, under the condemnation and judgment of God. Why? Because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So again, as we review, there's only two agendas in the whole world. There's God's agenda and Satan's agenda. There are only two different people groups in the whole world. There are the lost and there are the saved. Now the question that I want to pose this morning is this. What are we going to do as believers in the face of this oncoming hostility? What are we going to do in terms of, are we just going to conform and give in and yield and concede and comply and compromise and simply go along to get along with Satan's agenda? Or as believers, are we going to stand against this tide no matter what it costs us? By the way, as a Tennessee fan, I like standing against the tide. Can I get an amen this morning? Listen to me carefully. Here's the message title, the theme of the message today. Yes, there are two agendas. Yes, there are two different groups of people, but you and I only, as a church, only have two options. Here they are. We can fight or we can fold. We can stand or we can compromise. Now, the next time we're in this series, after our revival next Sunday, I want to talk about the weapons that we've been given to fight with, because our weapons are totally different. One of our weapons, Jill sang about just a while ago, it's the Word of God, the gospel, of sharing God's gospel with the lost and dying world. But listen to me carefully, church. I want you to hear this. We are in it to win it, or we are just in this thing because Jesus makes us have a warm, fuzzy feeling all over. You know, a puppy will make you have a warm, fuzzy feeling all over. Everybody say it together now. Aww. Jesus warned about the warm, fuzzy folks when he spoke about the soils and the Word of God. Some would receive it, he said, with great joy, and yet it would not last. Now listen to me. This is where a lot of believers are today. Matthew 13, 21, Jesus said he endures only for a while, for when tribulation and persecution arises. Listen, because of what, church? The Word. Do you hear that? The Word. When tribulation and persecution arises because they believe and they're standing on the Word, or the Word contradicts what everybody else in the world is talking about, immediately this guy, the warm fuzzy guy, stumbles. I want you to get that in your heart. Listen, far too few believers realize that our commitment to Christ immediately puts us on a battlefield. Not a playground, but a battlefield. It puts us smack dab in the middle of an all-out war between God's agenda, truth, and Satan's agenda, lies. That's why over and over in the Bible, you hear language of warfare. You hear warfare language. Let's look at it together in Jude, and then we're going to look at a lot of other scripture today. So I hope you're ready to dive into the Word of God. Let's feast a little on the Word of God this morning. Jude, the half-brother of Jesus, said this. Look at Jude 1, beginning with verse 3. Beloved, he's talking to Christians. While I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, Jude was saying, you know what? I wanted to talk to you about salvation by grace through faith. That's what I intended to do. That's what I really wanted to do. I wanted to write to you happy thoughts, but I couldn't. I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you. Now listen, to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. The word contend there comes from the wrestling world of Paul's day. It's actually the word from which we get our word agony or agonize. It means not only to wrestle, it means to fight. And the idea behind this word is hand-to-hand combat, to confront, to strain against, to work tirelessly, to oppose. And it's in the present infinitive. You say, what does that mean, Pastor? It means that this fight is continuous. There are no breaks. There are no rounds for us. It is a continuous battle, a continuous, never-ending struggle. That means, listen, we cannot quit. We cannot. Sunday school teacher, did you hear what I said? You can't quit. Bible teacher, preacher, we got a lot of preachers that listen to the message. You can't quit. Believer, we've got to zealously be faithful to the Lord until we take our last breath, until the day He calls us home. We've got to be true to the gospel and to the Word of the living God. Contend earnestly for the faith once delivered to the saints. By the way, I read something a couple of weeks ago that I wanted to share with you, because I believe it captures where so many so-called Christians are today. It came from the book by Robert Bella, book Habits of the Heart. And he talks about a nurse by the name of Sheila. Now listen to this. Sheila says this, "Well, I have my own little faith. I believe in God. I also believe in live and let live. I don't go to church, but I do have faith. I call it Sheilaism. Just my own little voice that speaks to me." Isn't that interesting? That's both not biblical and pitiful at the same time. There's so many believers like that. "Well, I believe in Jesus, but I just kind of have my own eclectic roll your own theology, and it's just going to be something between me and the Lord, and the church is out of the question." Listen, that's why we need to contend for the faith today. Why? Look at verse 4. "For certain men have crept in unnoticed, like cockroaches. They come in through the cracks and the crevices, who long ago were marked out for this condemnation. Their judgment has already been set and secured by the Lord." We've been talking about Malachi in our Sunday school class. And by the time you get to Malachi chapter 2, the prophet Malachi thunders out against the corrupt religious leaders of his day. They had departed from the way. They had deceived the people of God. They had defiled God's covenant, and they were despised of the Lord because of it. Now I want you to look at the next part of verse 4, because this is where many pulpits are today. This is where many churches are today. Look at the next part. "Ungodly men who turn the grace of our God into lewdness." Let that sink in again. "Ungodly men who turned the grace of our God into lewdness." Listen to me carefully. If you ever hear a preacher or a church say that every kind of vile, sick sin is acceptable with God because of His grace, Jude said, that dude is a false prophet, and they are marked for the destruction from God. Did you hear about the stir this past week in Katy, Texas, a suburb of Houston, Brother Tim? The Christian church there in Katy, Texas has decided to have drag queen bingo. Ungodly men who turn the grace of our God into what, church? Lewdness. Be careful. Be careful if you're going to a church or all you hear is grace, grace, grace without any truth. Jesus was a perfect combination of both grace and truth. You and I had better approach this word with much fear and trembling. This is not something to play around with. This is not something to monkey with. This is not something to compromise with. Else, look what'll happen. We will deny the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. We will come up denying the Father and the Son. We're in a battle. Paul charged Timothy to fight the good fight of warfare in 1 Timothy 1:18. He said later on, fight the good fight of faith, 1 Timothy 6:12. That's war language. Battle language. He commanded him in 2 Timothy 2, you therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. 2 Timothy 2, 3 and 4. He gave the church at Philippi two commands, and both of them come using warfare language. He said, stand firm in one spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel. Both of those terms are military terms. In 2 Corinthians 10, he says, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, fleshly. I'm going to be preaching on that in a couple of weeks. But mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds. To the church at Ephesus, he declares, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against the spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to do through things, withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand. Amen. Folks, that is not kumbaya language. That's warfare language. Amen. That's fighting for the faith language. And this requires soldiers willing to die for their commander in chief. By the way, did you know this? Did you know that there are two complete denominations that have removed the song Onward Christian Soldiers from the hymnal, from their hymnal? Did you know that? It happened back in 1982. They removed it because it smacked too much of military. But what about the Word of God? We got warfare language all over the Scriptures. But that song is no longer acceptable in the eyes of some who, of course, continue to deny the Word of God. Now, before you sign up, before you say, yeah, I want to be a part of that army. I want to be a part of that group that is going to contend for the faith, that's going to stand strong, that's not going to compromise God's agenda. I want to follow the Bible. I want to be a soldier of the cross. Sign me up. I have decided to follow Jesus. Before you do that, you need to do what Jesus said in Luke 14. If you follow me, you better count the cost. Amen. You better count the cost. Is there a cost in following Jesus? Listen to me, salvation is a free gift of God. But is there going to be a cost to us if we want to be a committed disciple and follower of Jesus and a follower of the Word of God in these pagan days that we're living in and the much more pagan days ahead? Is there going to be a cost involved? I believe there will. And I believe there will be some significant costs involved. For instance, let me give you a few things. I believe if you sign up for the Lord Jesus and you want to become a committed soldier of the cross and stand on this book, it's going to cost you some friends. It's going to cost you some friends. When I became a believer, I had a whole ton of non-believing friends. And listen, I loved them, and I enjoyed their friendship and their company. And I wanted to witness to them as a believer. I wanted them to be saved, but I couldn't run with them anymore. I couldn't run with them anymore because we were no longer running in the same direction. I had to walk away from some of my running around buddies, if you know what I'm talking about. I was following Jesus now, and they were not. It was hard to do, but I had to do it. You want to become a committed follower of Jesus Christ and His Word? Listen to me, before you sign on the dotted line, you better understand it might cost you some friendships that you've had in the past. It might cost you, secondly, some family. Some family. Pastor, my family won't even talk to me anymore. They think I've joined, I joined First Baptist Morristown. They think I've joined some kind of cult church. They're so lost. They're living without any regard for God. Now they've written me off just because I love Jesus. Many of our family members are excited about our faith and they are filled with joy because we know Christ. But boy, there's a lot of people that when they come to know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, their family turns their back on them. Their family says no. Their family forsakes them. Are we willing to go through that in the future? It might cost that. It might cost us, thirdly, financially. Remember the wealthy young man that came to Jesus, approached Jesus and said, "How do I have eternal life?" Jesus asked him a very Jewish question. "Son, have you kept the commandments?" because that was the Jewish perception of how you were right with God. You kept the 613 mitzvot, or commandments of God. And he said, yes, I have done that since I was young. What was he talking about? He was talking about his bar mitzvah. When you were 12, if you're Orthodox, 13 now in the Reform movement, but 12 or 13 years old, you took the next step into manhood or womanhood, and you became a son or a daughter of the commandments. Bar, son of, mitzvah, commandments. Bar mitzvah. Yes, I have kept all the commandments. I like what Rabbi Greg has said to us before about present day bar mitzvahs. He said there's a whole lot more bar than there is mitzvah. I've kept it all. Jesus knew that he had not kept them all. By the way, if you want to be saved like that, you got to keep them all. Because James says, you mess up on one and you're out. That's why we need his grace. Thank him for his grace. Luke 18, so when Jesus heard these things, he said to him, you still lack one thing, young man. You see, Jesus knew this guy had other gods in his life that were before God in heaven. It was his money. It was his riches. He'd not kept all the commandments. He'd already violated the first of the commandments. Take what you have and distribute it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. Count the cost, young man. But when he heard this, he became very sorrowful, for he was very rich. Is it going to cost me financially to be a true disciple of Christ? Yep. Even if it's just your tithe. You say, man, if I didn't tithe, I could buy that boat I've been wanting. I could redo my whole wardrobe. I could knock out that wall and make me have the big space that everybody talks about and marble countertops. I could have all of that if I just didn't tithe. They're going to cost you financially to follow Jesus. I'm not talking about salvation. I'm talking about making him the Lord of your life. At the very least, your tithe is going to cost you. But what if it cost you even more than that? I've shared with you before about the young Jewish man, 20 years old in our church, my first church out of seminary in South Florida, came forward one Sunday, gave his heart and life to Jesus. I was going to baptize him the next Sunday, and he called me on Thursday, and he said, Pastor, I've got a situation. I just want to talk with you about it. My grandparents heard that I believe in Jesus now and that I'm going to be baptized on Sunday. They said if I follow through with it, that they will write me out of their will as if I never was born, and I will be written out of literally millions of dollars of inheritance. What should I do? I said, Adam, you're the only one that's going to be able to answer that, my friend. I said, you have to come to the grips of what you did and what it means to you, and you are the one that's going to have to answer that. On that following Sunday, he showed up and he said, I'm ready to be baptized. And they wrote him out of the will as if he was never born before. Now, some of us may never have to face that, but I'm telling you, it's going to cost you financially if you want to make this kind of stand. If you want to make this kind of fight. Oh, you can limp along and give a penny every now and then or a dime and praise the Lord, but no, not if you want to be right with God. Amen. Not if you want to make him your Lord and be a true disciple of Jesus. It may cost you, here's a fourth thing, it may cost you some future opportunities. You may not get the position that you wanted simply because you are a believer in Jesus Christ. You may not get the promotion. You may not get the contract. You may have to say no to some contracts that would come your way. You may lose the contract. As a matter of fact, the day may come when you may lose your job. Am I willing to commit my life to Jesus like that? Where it might even cost me my livelihood, it might even cost me my job, it might even, here's the fifth thing, it might even decide your fate someday. When Stephen decided to oppose a hostile world, he stood up and preached the truth of God, and the Bible says in Acts chapter 7, the crowd responded in five ways. See if this is not coming our way, church. Listen what it says. Then they cried out with a loud voice. They stopped their ears. They ran at him with one accord. Nothing draws the devil's crowd in great unity like opposing Christ and the cause of Christ. They cast him out of the city, and then they stoned him. They killed him. You say, Pastor, that's not going to happen in America. People are not going to die for their faith. Well, let me tell you something. 900,000 of them have died in the past 10 years. 900,000 of our brothers and sisters have died in the past 10 years. 90,000 in just this year alone. That's one believer every 6 minutes that it has cost them their life in order to stand for the gospel. For some of us, it may just be a little persecution or opposition. But for some, it may even be far costlier. So let me ask you a question today. Is it going to be worth it in the days ahead to fight? To stand? Or wouldn't it just be a little smoother and easier if we just kind of smile and go along and not stand up for the Word of God? Wouldn't that be a lot more pleasant? You say, my life would be so much easier if I didn't have to battle everybody and say, listen, I'm standing on the Word of God. So what are we going to do? We can fight spiritually. I'm not talking about fighting with cussing and weapons, and that's not what I'm talking about. We'll talk about how we fight in a couple of weeks. I'm talking about making a stand on the Word. We're going to compromise? What do we do? I want to share with you some verses. Just look at the screen. And I believe these verses will be very, very encouraging to all of us who've decided, no, I'm not going to compromise. I'm not going to go along to get along. I'm not going to be a part of that crowd. Listen to what Jesus said, Matthew chapter 5, in His very first sermon. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Peter said to Jesus in Mark chapter 10, we've left all, Jesus, to follow you. So Jesus answered and said, now listen to this, I'm claiming this. Assuredly, I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my sake and the gospel's who shall not receive 100-fold now in this time, 100 times as many houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecution. In other words, we got a big family, but we're going to share in that persecution together. And in the age to come, Jesus said, eternal life. Amen. The Hebrews writer said to the Messianic Jews, but recall the former days in which after you were illuminated. By the way, that's how a Jewish person gets saved. They're blinded, and when they come to know Christ, the Holy Spirit opens their eyes and they say, of course. How could I have not seen that Jesus was the Messiah? Here's the Hebrew writer says, recall your former days in which after you were illuminated, after your eyes were opened, listen what they went through. You endured a great struggle with sufferings, partly while you were made a spectacle, both by reproaches and tribulations, and partly while you became companions of those who were so treated. Now, for those of you who believe that Paul was the writer of Hebrews, here's the key verse where many believe that he was the writer. I have no opinion, but here's what they believe. For you had compassion on me in my chains. This is somebody writing from prison. And joyfully accept, now listen, joyfully accepted the plundering of your goods. Are we willing to do that? You mean give up stuff that I have? half the stuff in my garage, I'd pay somebody to take it. You know what I'm talking about? And joyfully accepted the plundering of your goods, knowing that you have a better and an enduring possession for yourselves in heaven. Therefore, do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward. Do we believe that? Do we believe that no matter how bad and dark it gets on this earth, it's going to be a better day someday? And the reward is waiting on us through Jesus Christ. James 1 says, blessed is the man who endures temptation, trials, for when he's been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Colossians 3, 23 and 24, whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord Christ. Jesus said to the church at Smyrna, John quoted this a while ago, do not fear any of those things which you're about to suffer. Indeed, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and you will have tribulation 10 days. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. Paul said in Galatians 6, 9, let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. He said in 2 Timothy 4, I fought the good fight. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith. Finally, there's laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. So, church, here's the deal. Are we going to fight or are we going to fold? Are we going to stand for Jesus and for the Word of God as a people and as a person who believes in Jesus? Amen. Or are we going to concede? Are we going to endure? Or are we going to fade? Are we going to contend for the faith? Or are we going to accommodate for the day and the culture in which we're living? Are we willing to make that decision today, right now, this very moment? We will stand on the Word of God. Amen. Our church will stand on the Word of God. We will not bow to Baal. We will not compromise our faith. Amen. I love what quarterback Drew Brees, who played for New Orleans, I love what he said about his career. Look at the screen. Look what he said. As a quarterback under pressure, would I fold and disappear, or would I show everyone that when bad things happen, you fight? Amen. You fight. I'm getting to be an old man now, but I'm telling you that God has burned the fight in my heart, and I will not compromise the faith or the Word of the living God. Some of you are in a fight right now. You're in a battle with the enemy. It seems like he's picking on you left and right. And I want to say to you, keep on keeping on. Don't throw in the towel. Don't quit. You keep trusting the Lord and looking to him at every point in your life. You keep on keeping on. Amen. And believing in him. No matter how hard it gets, will you be found faithful, or will you dishonor our Lord through compromise? Will we fight, or will we fold?